I'm Danny, and this is Asha. We're two Kiwis who, after 5 years living in London, decided to head home the slow way. We bought a 36-foot sailing boat, Bacchus, built a little rowing and sailing dinghy, Piwaka Waka, and headed towards the horizon. These are our adventures. So we're into our fourth week of the lockdown and we're running out of things to do, so we're going to give you a tour of Bacchus. And I've got Asha, captain, right here. He's going to explain a few things that we've done to our boat.
Yeah, so when we bought Bacchus, she wasn't equipped for going cruising at all. She was very much a weekend boat that lived in a marina. So we had to do quite a bit of work to her to get her ready for this trip. And we thought it might be interesting for you guys, maybe, to have a bit of a tour of those different upgrades that we did. So one of the big upgrades that we did to Bacchus was fitting a solar panel. We wanted to be able to produce renewable energy while we were sailing so that we wouldn't have to run the main engine or run a petrol generator like some boats do. We've fitted a single solar panel on the back of the boat. It's a big LG panel. On the box, I think it says it's good for 350 watts. In the middle of the day, when the sun's overhead, we get about 20 to 25 amps coming out of that panel, which is more than enough to keep us happy. We've actually never had a problem with electricity on Bacchus since we installed the panel, which is great. So the fridge runs all the time. We have the lights on all night. We can charge computers and phones and run the stereo. Electricity is not a problem, which is really cool. And of course, to fit the big solar panel, we needed a big frame to put it on. So we got this stainless steel frame made for us in New Haven in the UK before we left. It was quite expensive, but it's proven to be really good. And it gives us a handy place to store the paddleboard, as you can see, when we're not using it. The solar panel, interestingly, is actually double-sided. So it does produce electricity from the underneath too, as well as the top. Obviously, when the paddleboard's in place, that's limited a bit, but it still produces plenty of power for us. Now, as anyone who's mucked around with power systems will know, the generating of the electricity is only half of the equation. You've also got to be able to store it. So we upgraded Bacchus's batteries. For our domestic batteries, we've got two Victron AGM Supercycle batteries. They're a conventional battery, but Victron have built them in such a way that they can cope with really deep discharge. So Victron says you can run them down to 30% state of charge or even 0% state of charge, which is completely dead, without ruining the battery. And on more traditional batteries, you can't do that. You can't really run them below about 50%. So having these batteries that can cope with really deep discharge means we actually needed less batteries because we can use all of the capacity of our battery bank if we need it, instead of only being able to use the top 50%. So our battery bank is two 170 amp hour Victron batteries. So we've got 340 amp hours total battery storage. And to be honest, it never really goes below about 75%. One piece of kit that we found uses a lot of electricity, far more than we ever anticipated, was the ship's autopilot. So we've got a hydraulic autopilot. It's a big, powerful hydraulic ram that drives the main rudder. And that sucks quite a lot of electricity if there's a big sea running and it's having to work hard. So as watchers of previous episodes will know, we fitted a wind self-steering system to take over from the autopilot. And everyone knows her name is Florence. And she's a hydrovane and she lives down here on the transom. So I won't go into detail about how Florence works. Safe to say that she uses no electricity, which has meant, like I said earlier, that our batteries are never really below about 75%. Fitting the hydrovane was pretty straightforward, although we had to be really accurate with our measurements. We had to cut the arms to the correct length, and then we had to shape these little timber pads that they sit on, and we had to make some backing plates to go on the other side. So on the inside of the boat here, there is plywood and 3mm aluminium plate. And then it's been bolted through with these big stainless bolts and a whole lot of glue, so the whole thing is like a big sandwich. So far it seems to be rock solid. So even though the autopilot uses a lot of electricity, it's still a really helpful piece of kit, which we really like. It is excellent whenever we're coming into a harbour and both of us need to go forward or both of us need to do a job, it's really good to just be able to push a button on the computer and the boat steers itself. We upgraded the autopilot when we were in Brighton. We fitted a Raymarine Evolution pilot, which in 2018 was the latest and greatest one, and that does a pretty good job of steering the boat. And that's the control panel for it here. We have also upgraded Bacchus's instruments, the wind instruments and the depth sounder and speed. And one of the driving factors behind that was because the new instruments can now talk to the autopilot. So the autopilot computer knows what the wind is doing, and therefore it can actually steer the boat to the wind in the same way that Florence steers the boat to the wind, which is really cool. So as well as the new Raymarine autopilot and the new Raymarine instruments, we also fitted an AIS system. AIS stands for Automatic Identification at Sea, and it's like a transponder that transmits our name and our position and our location and our direction of travel through the radio, and it allows other boats around us to see us on their AIS screen and for us to see them. It's a little bit like radar. So we fitted a Vespa AIS unit, which is a good New Zealand company. We've also fitted an Iridium satellite connection, which is called an Iridium Go. And that gives us a very, very slow internet connection when we're offshore. So it lets us download emails, download weather forecasts, and it lets us make voice calls. If we got into trouble and we needed to call for help, we have a VHF radio, which only has a range of about 30 miles. And then we've got the Iridium, which we can place a phone call to anywhere in the world with. And finally, in terms of finding out where exactly we are in the world, we use Navionics, like a lot of sailors, and we just run that on an iPad down at the chart table. So that's a there's a GPS system there that tells us where we are, and it shows where any hazards are. We use that in conjunction with our paper charts. We've also got a handheld VHF, of course, and also a handheld GPS unit too, as a backup, just in case any of that stuff fails.
Great, and then what else is going on the back of the boat here?
And down here on the transom, this is where we keep the spare boat, also known as the life raft. We have a freshwater shower, which pulls out there, which is pretty nice for rinsing off the salt after you've had a swim. We have the swim ladder here, and then over on this side we have our Kiwi Sizzler barbecue, which normally gets put away in a locker when we're sailing. We did get it out on the Atlantic and did Christmas Day steaks on it, but being able to barbecue when we're at anchor is really nice. Keep some of the smoke out of the galley.
And that is linked up to its own gas bottle.
Yeah.
It sits on the rail over there.
Its own gas bottle there. And then we've got ship's gas bottles for the galley, live in the gas locker down there.
So what else is going on in the cockpit?
So we've just got storage underneath the seats. So this is our small locker. It's pretty chocker, but it's got things like fishing gear, mooring lines, spare diesel, some greases and various lubricants for the engine, some tools, bits and pieces like that. And then on this side, we've got an enormous locker.
Shall we climb in?
Yeah. Down into the cave. Oh. So here on this wall, we've got the solar charge controller. So the power from the solar panels comes in through these cables, and this guy is in charge of keeping our batteries happy. He makes sure that the right amount of current goes down to the batteries. Now those fancy Victron batteries I was talking about are living in here. There they are, they've got their seat belts on so they can't move. And so those are our domestic batteries, which power everything aside from starting the engine. And then the two circuit breakers that you can see there, one is for the charge controller and the other is for the inverter, which is just on the other side of this wall in the galley. But you can see how big this is. A tremendous amount of room for storing things down here, which is really helpful. We've also got a bimini, which is just like a sunroof really, just gives us a little bit of shade. So this piece here, just it all folds forward and it zips onto the top of the spray hood. We can have that up when we're sailing, but we definitely have it up when we're at anchor to give us a bit of shade. This is our enormous spray hood, which is huge, but does give us a lot of room. What we found though is it's so good at sheltering the wind from the cockpit that the cockpit gets too hot. So we put some zips into the front, which allows us to unzip the front panel and roll it up. And then we can have some breeze coming through the cockpit, which is really nice.
It makes a huge difference having the breeze coming through in here. Where are we now?
So these devices here and here, on a racing boat they'd be called keyboards. I don't know what they call them on cruising boats. But this is where we handle all of the lines which control all of Bacchus's sails. So the way these keyboards work, you can always pull the rope this way coming through towards you. But to let the rope go out, you've got to open up that handle. So it's like a one-way system. Now the rope can come in, but it won't go out. On this side, we've got that one. There's the uphaul for the end of the boom. This is our main sheet. This is the pole up, and this is the spinnaker halyard. Spinnaker halyard's the one that we use to lift Piwaka Waka on board each day. And then on this side, we've just got more sail control lines. So we've got three reefs, one, two, and three, which make our mainsail smaller or bigger, depending on how strong the wind is. The fancy red one is the main halyard. This is the Vang or Kicker. This is the Genoa halyard. And then this one over here is a Dyneema line, which is very low stretch. And we use that for tensioning our inner forestay, which we fitted. The ropes like this are all called running rigging, and they're something that wear out periodically on a boat. So we've had to replace a couple of these. You can see the main halyard is pretty shiny. That's actually brand new. We just fitted that one the other day because the old one was worn out. And then we got two winches which tension those lines. They're called secondary winches. The boat's primary winches are behind us on each side, and those are used to trim the Genoa, which is our big pencil.
So should we go check out the front of the boat?
Let's.
These are our washboards, so it's like our front door, that's where we keep them. They just slot into the front door there. And over this side in this bag we've got mosquito nets which fit over our hatches and over the companionway so we can have everything open when it's hot but not get mozzies.
This unit here is the Traveller, which helps us trim the mainsail, lets us position the main sheet either to port or starboard. And we actually fitted this unit new in the Canaries. I don't know if you recall, but we had a problem with the old toggle here which was worn out on the old unit. We weren't able to fix it, so we ended up fitting a whole new Traveller. So that's that there. So by releasing one end and pulling on the other, we can move that main sheet sheeting point either to port or starboard.
So these here are called jack stays, and we've fitted them on both sides of the decks. And they are to tie onto to hook our life jackets onto when we need to go on deck when we're out at sea, just to keep us safe and to keep us on the boat.
We bought a new mainsail for Bacchus before we left. The old one was a little bit tired and it only had two reefs. We really wanted to have three reefs before we went offshore so that we could make the sail really small if we had to, if we encountered a storm or something. So the mainsail was new the other year, but of course it's done a few miles now. Something we had to change in the Canaries again, this was a job that Danny did, was fitting these little cars which help it slide smoothly. You can see they've got little wheels on them. What the sail had before that and what it still has on the lower section are these little plastic slugs which do the same job, but they're just not quite as free-flowing as the cars are.
And in terms of other sails?
Yeah, so in terms of other sails, we've obviously got our big Genoa which is on the roll of furler, and that was original when we bought the boat. We haven't changed that. We also bought two second-hand sails, a smaller headsail, it's about a number four size, which we fly from the removable inner forestay, and then we've also got a storm jib, which we'd fly off the removable forestay as well if we ever needed it. We haven't needed it yet, and hopefully we won't. Cross fingers, touch wood, all that.
So one thing we don't have on our mast is some steps, so it makes it quite challenging to get up. We have a harness, and Asher usually climbs and I just tail from the cockpit, but it is a lot trickier than if you had a ladder or some steps. So that's something we're going to look at installing while, possibly while we're in Panama, to help us get up the mast a little bit easier. And in the Pacific, there's a lot of reefs, and so there's a real advantage to be able to get up your mast and to be able to look down when the sun's high in the sky and be able to spot your path in safely.
So this is our removable inner forestay that we fitted. It's made of Dyneema, and then we had to rivet a tang onto the top of the mast there for it to attach to. Dyneema is incredibly strong and quite slippery. It's low friction and it's very low stretch, which is good. So it normally lives cleated off at the foot of the baby stay here when we're not using it. When we are using it, we unclip it and we take it forward. There is a soft shackle which is sort of plaited onto this low friction ring at the bottom, and that soft shackle goes onto the pad eye at the front of the boat here, like so. And then those two low friction rings create a purchase system, and we can put this line onto the winch at back there at the keyboards, and we can tension it up and the whole thing goes bar tight, and then we can fly either our storm jib or our number four.
And that pad eye is strong enough to take that amount of power that's coming through the...
Yeah, so the pad eye itself is quite a solid piece of engineering, but of course it's only as strong as what it's fixed to. So what we've done down here in the anchor locker is we have attached the pad eye onto the front chain plate. The front chain plate being the strong point that this forestay attaches to. And we've done that by means of a backing plate with an eye and then some Dyneema lashings.
Okay, and what else is on the bow here?
So also at the front of the boat, we've got the new roller furler which we fitted in the Canary Islands. The old one was jamming, so we've got a new profurl unit there. Yeah, the piece of kit that lets me sleep at night, which is our anchor. It's a Rockner, another New Zealand company. We've got a 20 kilo one. And it's on the end of 70 metres of 8mm chain. We added another 20 metres to get that number, so we're just to give us a little bit more potential for scope. We know how much chain we've let out because we've got painted markers on the chain, but of course these come off because every time the chain goes through this windlass they get knocked over, so it's an ongoing job to repaint those chain markers. But the anchor's fantastic. It's never slipped for us, so we're really pleased with it. And then finally on the anchor subject, we've made this anchor bridle which has got two legs. I've only got one leg attached at the moment, which is there. But it basically just transfers the load of the anchor onto these mooring cleats because they're quite strong. And it means that there isn't actually any load on the chain at this section where the windlass is, because this windlass is strong but it's not designed to handle the all-day loads of the boat blowing around on the anchor. So the bridle just takes those loads and sends them to the mooring cleat.
Okay, moving to starboard.
Yeah, so over here we've got a whole lot of fresh water and jerry cans. We've got 150 litres of fresh water here, and that goes with the 300 and something litres that are in the two existing tanks downstairs. And then we also fitted a third water tank on the port side which holds about 80 litres. So all told we've got around about 500 and something litres of fresh water. In the galley we've fitted a foot fresh water pump, which means you use a lot less water than if you're using a regular tap. And we've also fitted a salt water pump as well. So we use salt water for washing dishes and like washing your hands and stuff as well, which also minimises our usage. Also up here in this part of the boat, we've got Piwaka Waka's sailing rig all packed away here. We've got the rudder for the hydrovane, and we've also got this lovely piece of bamboo, which is my second spinnaker pole. My first spinnaker pole is the aluminium one down here, but we use those two poles when we're flying the two headsails, one on each side for downwind work.
People quite often ask us what this piece of plumbing is here. It's exactly that, it's just a piece of plumbing, but we use it to put the GoPro in so that we can film while we're sailing. So that's everything above deck. We'll go down below now and check out the inside. So first up down below we have the galley. And we're really lucky in Bacchus because we've got a lot of space in our galley for a boat our size. And the reason we've got so much space is because we went for the two cabin model of the Beneteau 361 as opposed to the three. So on the three cabin model there's a room here and we don't get any of the space for the kitchen, but for us we do. So we've got a big back bench over here and a front opening fridge which can store quite a lot of food in and gets pretty packed up before we go on passage. And over here is a cool box if you want to have a look. It's really deep. It's got no refrigeration in it, but it's insulated and we can top that right up as well for anything that we don't mind getting a little bit damp but doesn't need to stay completely cold. Other storage options are behind here. We keep all of our bowls and our cutlery. And then we've got these three top cupboards here for all of our tin cans, baking and spices and stuff, and everything goes in here. So in these we just try and keep a couple of cans of the regular stuff that we use, and all of our backup supplies are in the saloon in big storage bins that we have in there, and we've got tons and tons of beans and chopped tomatoes and those sorts of things. We have a gimbal oven which is very handy when you're out at sea. We bake bread in this oven, we've done a roast in this oven, so it works quite well. It's just hooked up to the gas. And over here we have a really big pantry which can fit loads of food in here, but it's also got our fridge motor in it, so we have to be careful not to overfill it too much because it needs to have enough air to keep the fridge fan cool. We changed the fridge fan early on when we first got the boat. The first one we had was really, really loud. It would wake us up in the night time when the fridge turned on. So that's been changed over. Other things we've done in the galley is installed these two foot taps here. So we do have an electric tap and it does have hot water, but we only get that hot water if we've been running the engine, which we rarely do, or if we're plugged into shore power. So we don't really use the electric tap very much, so we use the foot taps. This one over here is the salt water, and this one over here is the fresh water. I won't use it right now, but we use salt water a lot, especially for doing dishes, and then we just spray with our fresh water spray, and that's a really good way for us to reduce the amount of fresh water that we're using. And under here, under the cupboard here, is all our cleaning and all of our pots. So we have actually installed a bottom to this cupboard. It didn't have one before, so that we can fit all of our pots in there nicely and they don't clunk around when we're on passage. And we've got one more little storage underneath the oven here, and that's got extra bits and pieces. Pretty much everything in this oven, in this galley, gets used very regularly. If it's not used, it gets thrown out because there's not much space, as you can see. But I did manage to sneak in this some mortar and pestle. It's very heavy. Asha really didn't want me to bring this on the boat, but we have some delicious curries because of it. Other things in the galley, Asha mentioned earlier about the inverter. This is it here, so that's on the other side of the deep locker. And what's that is doing, it's converting the energy from the batteries into 240 volts so we can use it for our appliances. So we have the clip-on fan up here that's plugged in, which is great for when you're cooking in the heat. But we also have an extension cord plugged in and it runs to the saloon, and that's where we can charge our cameras and our laptops and all those sorts of things. It's only 800 watts, so say goodbye to hair dryers and hair straighteners or any kitchen appliances like blenders, etc. We can't use them on it, but it does mean that we have always got power on the boat, which is great. What else? Oh, we installed these two hammocks, these Progis hammocks. This one here we installed just before the Atlantic crossing, and at the moment when we're not on passage we just use it really for storing Tupperware, but when we are on passage it's filled with onions and cabbages. And this is our main Progis hammock, and this one is obviously, as you can see, filled with whatever fresh fruit and vegetables we can find. What else is in here? The EPIRB So Asher talked earlier about the life raft on the back of the boat. If we were to use that at any point, we would also take the EPIB, emergency position, identification, rescue beacon, something like that. Anyway, the reason it's put here is because as we go out the companionway, you can really quickly grab it and take it with you. We would take that, we would take the grab bag, which sits under the sink here with the rubbish bin, this big bag. That's got emergency supplies in it for if we were out at sea for a while, and we'd also clip off a jerry can of water to take with us. There is water in the grab bag as well. For if any reason we lost that big jerry can, we do have water there. It's the most important thing to have. But we hope we never have to use those things. Next up on the tour is the companionway, and under here, this flicks up and this is where our engine lives. Asher has spent a lot of time with his head in the engine. It is a Volvo Penta
MD2030.
Almost. You've changed the starter motor on that, haven't you?
Yeah, the engine's got a new starter motor that we put on, and that's about the only thing that we've really had to replace on it, aside from just servicing it and changing filters and stuff. It's a really good little engine. It's never let us down. It starts first pop. It's never really had any significant problems, except I struggled to get the cooling system to work properly. The engine's never overheated, but I've had lots of leaks in the cooling system, and that's my ongoing battle.
One thing I forgot to mention about the galley, so that when we got Bacchus, there was the fire extinguisher here. This is for my dad, by the way. There was a fire extinguisher here. We moved it because if there was to be a fire in the galley, it would be here over the oven. And reaching over here is quite a dangerous thing to do to try and get it. So we've moved it. It's now in the saloon, which I'll show you in a second. But we do have a fire blanket, which is just here, which we could rip off in a hurry and chuck over. So that's for you, Dad. Okay. Next on the tour is the guest bedroom. Follow me in. This is also doubles as Ash's room. He keeps all of his clothes in here. And also our room when we are on passage, because it's too uncomfortable for us to sleep up front when we're sailing, so we use here or in the saloon. Because it's the two cabin model, it is really quite a big bed. It's quite luxurious, which you'd think is a great thing, but actually when you're out at sea you sort of want less room to be able to throw yourself around in, so you sort of have to try and cuddle up in the corner. It has got a nice decent sized wardrobe in it. And we've installed a fan, you can see here, just to help keep things cool. And it's got this little window here, which goes out into the cockpit. So when someone's on watch and someone's asleep, you can actually talk to each other through here, which is quite nice as well. And there's another window up here to get a bit more air in. Next up is the head. That is what you call a bathroom on a boat. It's quite roomy. It actually has a shower in half of it. So it's got the shower here, but we don't use it. We actually, as you can see, storage is everything on a boat, so we've turned it into a storage room full of everything. What we have done in here is on a very early episode when we're still in the UK, Asher installed the holding tank, which is a pretty gross thing to actually have on a boat, but it's really good because it means we can basically go to any anchorage we want. A lot of places won't let you anchor there if you don't have a black water tank, and it also means that we can go swimming off the boat at any point and know that, you know, we're swimming in quite nice water. This mirror opens up. It's got a bit of storage out under there. That's about all for the head. Okay. Next is the chart table, which doubles as Ash's tool shed. He keeps all of his tools under there. And he spoke to you earlier about the instruments that we've got on the boat. So here is our VHF. This is the boat tablet. So this is where we use Navionics and the AIS. This is our Iridium, which is our satellite phone and also acts as our internet when we're out at sea. It actually connects to your phone, so That's how I'd make a call off my own mobile phone, but I'd connect it to the Iridium, or if we were downloading a weather forecast, we'd connect the iPad to the Iridium and then download it that way. This one here is just a simplified version of the battery monitor. And you can scroll through and it gives you the current details of our battery bank. So we're currently at 87.3%. And in the desk are a whole lot of paper charts, which we use in conjunction with our Navionics digital charts. So we've got a whole lot of charts in here, and it's always good to be using paper charts and digital stuff together. Okay, then we have our wonderful saloon. We have a table that pops up like this, and these pull in, which means we can have a nice dinner party with people over, which is really nice. There is storage behind and underneath both of the couches. So you can see in behind this here, there's storage behind, and also, as I mentioned earlier, we keep all of our food supplies under these as well. So if I just pull this one up for a second, you'll see here's one of our cupboards, and we've got one on the other side as well. Also on this side, we have what's called a lee cloth, and that comes out like this, and it hooks up to these metal clip ones here. One is here and one's on the other side, and it basically acts as like a canvas hammock. So when we are sleeping here on passage, if the boat tacks or we come off a wave, you won't fall out onto the floor. Oh, other things under here actually is under this, in this cupboard here, is our flexible water tank, which we installed as a third water tank on board. As Asher mentioned earlier, about to try and have as much fresh water as we can. Asher installed bookshelves on both sides. When we first bought Bacchus, these were just open shelves, which are fine when you're in the marina, but as soon as you go sailing, anything that you've put on it will fall off as soon as the boat heels over. So these nicely reinforced bookshelves keep all our books on. We've got some USB points that have been installed over there for charging things. Cheeky little wine cellar in the table. And a few other little storage cupboards dotted around just to keep extra bits and pieces, more alcohol necessary on the boat. Florence's sail lives up here while we're at anchor, but obviously goes and sits on Florence when we're sailing. We've also installed this nice towel hammock to keep all our towels in. This is a nice little oil lamp that has been installed and is quite romantic in the evenings. And this friendly face here is Ash's dad, who was a very good sailor and looks after us while we're on our journeys. And so the last room on the boat is our bedroom, which has a nice triangular shaped bed, and believe it or not, Asher and I both fit in there, but it is rather snug. It's where all my storage is, so all my clothes are in there. I've got my own wardrobe here. That's pretty much every item of clothing I own. Asher did install another fan in here, and under this bed we also have more storage. So we've got one of our big water tankers up here, and also we store a lot of light items like pasta and chips and that sort of thing. And we also have storage underneath the floorboards in the bilge, so we store water and milk and things like that all underneath there.
So this is the warp for the spare anchor, and then the chain is on the other side here. They're joined together, so that's ready to go if we ever needed it. So that's our boat. That's Bacchus. She's been a fantastic little floating home for us. We've really enjoyed living on board. We think she's the perfect size for two people to go cruising around the world. If you've got any questions about the boat, or any questions about the things that we did, just send us a message either in the comments or otherwise, and we'd love to talk more about it.
as always, if you do want to support us, just jump over to our Patreon page, and there's a few options on there on how you can get behind our YouTube channel.
Joyce.